Previously on Heroes and Hot Dogs, our heroes rested up for the night, but in the middle of the night, the cleric noticed that the wizard had turned to stone. Concerned for his safety, he woke up the monk and they began to try to wake the wizard. He was finally awoken when his name was called, and he turned back into flesh. The wizard told them he used to be a lawn gnome and was brought to life with errant animation magic and still returns to his lawn gnome form every night as he sleeps. They returned to bed, and the next day, the cleric fashioned new limbs for himself and Marcus before heading out. The monk and Marcus explored one side of the island and discovered quicksand, and the cleric and wizard went back to the beach, where they were the day before, and found the animal they had defeated now were seemingly very docile, but the remainder of their friends were still aggressive. They spent the day tossing coconuts all along the sand to locate the places that we safe to step. The party gathered at camp and brought a giant plank they had asked the dwarves to cut them back down to the beachhead. They placed the plank across the beach down to the safety of the water from a nearby cliff, and they walked the rowboat down to the water, but slipped and it careened the rest of the way, picking up Marcus as it went. The party got into the boat and began to finally set off into open water. So that's where we leave off today. And you guys said you are headed east towards Hawk's Rest, which is the closest island. Your boat moves at a fairly sluggish pace. You move at 3 miles per hour, at 24 miles per day. Yes, so you, it's difficult because they're not 100% on hexes, but basically you're a hex and a half away, pretty much, I will say, approximately.
Yeah, well, less, but
you're two hexes away because you started off at the southern shore.
Yeah.
Right. So you're like the bottom middle there. So that's the edge of that hex. So you're two hexes away, unfortunately, with the angle there too. So you're two full days away. The way this works is every day of sea travel, I'm gonna have you guys roll a bunch of numbers. And we're gonna see what happens. Hold on.
What an interesting number.
Oh, okay. I love you. And he's like, oh, okay. He just screaming at your love. Okay. All right. Cool. Cool. He rejected your love. Okay. She left him and said, "I loved you," and he just screamed, "No!"
Okay then, I don't love you.
Right, okay. Bye.
Mom, rules for love. Scores a one.
There you go. All right, so you were assigned roles, or you assigned yourselves a role, I should say, last time for who is the quartermaster, captain, first mate, and bosun. Marcus is the bosun. I believe, let me put in parentheses here who everybody's going to be. First mate was Finnegan.
Yes.
Finnegan? Yeah, here we go. Captain was Weaver. Captain Weaver. And quartermaster was Nomad. Okay, and I don't roll for Marcus because he's just the bosun, so he does repairs. He doesn't do rolls for travel. I'm going to have... All right, Nomad, you are the quartermaster, so you're in charge of plotting courses through weather. So you roll a d20 and add your survival, and you roll for weather.
Do it now, you're talking about?
Do it now.
Okay, well, I got to figure out what my... What did you say it is? It's...
Survival.
Survival. Survival.
A d20 plus survival.
I'm a zero. Okay.
This is a survival check. That's right, you'll get better. I'm sure that probably. Here.
Is there assisting with this?
Nope. There's no assisting with this. You all have separate roles. All right. So this is a 10. All right. Hold on.
Oh, right. You said no assisting. Is that what your question was?
Yeah. You don't get assisted. Yeah. No. Let me hit that my chart real quick. It's a DC plus 5. Okay. That's good. All right. So you have. Clear weather. You have clear sunny skies on the first day of travel. Yeah, there you go.
I like the implication that the weather is based on his ability to discern it.
Well, there's
a Schrodinger's cat of weather, if you will.
Yeah, you're right. No, survival is
no,
not.
No, you see, as in you're able to see the clouds and see the direction at the bad weather feeling, and you are able to avoid it, basically.
Oh, there you go.
That's a better way of putting that.
You're able to plot your way through, but today was actually sunny skies all the way through. You didn't actually encounter any weather to avoid or not, so.
Okay.
All right,
little
Captain.
Did he know, but the clouds were simply always behind him.
Nice. All right, Captain Weaver, roll for exploration, which is going to be perception. Roll a perception check. And I have to check. Okay.
I saw it.
It's a 19. Okay. All right, this is going to be fun. What's my 19 say?
I don't know if I like
all right. Thing. Yes, yes, yes. Good. This works out perfectly. Because I needed you to find an island. So you found it. All right. So often in, I have to do all of this in sequence, but it's going to kind of go in a different order eventually. But I'm letting you know now, based on your roll, off in the distance, you see land. If you
which
wish,
direction from us?
Is going to be the map real quick. Going to be a little bit towards. It's basically you have to go north a bit. It's not too far out of your way though. It's going to be pretty much, it's only like an extra like mile out of your route. It's not going to be a big deal. Okay. If you want to go that direction, so you can get to that in a minute. But I need to do everything else first. So I'm letting you know that there is land ho, off in the distance.
Actually, funny. That's just what I wrote down.
all right, and now we have Finnegan. Roll a stealth check.
Okay.
Well, okay.
Wait, sorry, I lost my tab for. There we go. My stealth modifier.
And better roll high.
Oh, boy.
Oh, no.
I got a 10. Wow.
All right, you got a 10. All right, let's see what we got here. Ooh. Okay.
A pack of whales.
Yep. Okay, here we go. All right, roll for me a d20.
I do not consent.
Eight.
No!
Open water encounter table. Okay, hang on. Please hold for me to determine. And now roll a d100 for me.
I say, what does a d100 look like?
An 11. Not great. All right.
How does that work? How many sided dice? Oh, it's 50 sided.
It's two D10s.
Yeah, basically.
One is the first digit, and the other is the second.
Where's the stupid? Hold on.
So one's 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, and the other one's 1 through 10. So you just add the 1 through 10.
But which one's which?
It's you can.
If
look
you
at
look
them.
At it, one has a 0 on it, and the other one does not.
Next you rolled an 11, correct? Yeah, 11.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I see. Okay, so I figured it out. I didn't realize that's how it worked.
Well, that's interesting. Okay. See Appendix C. Hold on.
Oh, my.
Okay.
Just roll backwards. You can only roll standard dice. You can't just use this as a random number.
Roll.
Yes, you can. Actually,
okay.
You can use a random number generator.
Roll 3d10.
I got a 5, a 6, and another 6. Equaling 17, by the way.
Yep, that is for quantity of creatures, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so you see land.
I freaking hate boats.
And, actually, hold on. I also need, I'll tell you what else you see, and I have to do another roll still, too. But you also see 17 creatures swimming in the water underneath you. And if you wish to see what they are, you can roll investigation.
Who's doing that?
That's Diggory.
Let me see if
you can tell what they are.
Again.
They are large fish-like aquatic creatures.
Hey, I was right. It was whales.
She just, oh my.
All right. You don't know what it is. It's large and fish-like.
That makes sense. I don't do fish.
And there are 17 of them. There's a large pack of these things. And they are moving quite fast.
Are they in our way to the island?
Hey guys,
yes.
Boat, the fish.
All right, so hold on. On top of that, I also need to do an additional as well. I'm going to roll myself a... Is there not a D100 on this thing?
Can you just say slash roll D100?
I just do slash roll and it worked. That's okay. That I don't use the menu. I always type, okay. Oh my goodness.
84. That doesn't mean anything. It's not higher numbers, it's better or anything.
It's just a random table.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
A bunch of bad things that can happen to us.
I'm trying to find... There it is. Okay. Here we go. I have a lot of tables. I'm sorry. All right. So... Wow, that's horrifying. All right.
I don't like this.
Okay, that'll be... that'll be something you come across... on the island, if you so choose to go there. There is land ho, and there are 17 aquatic creatures around you, and you can see in the distance on the land that there appear to be large, you want to say like trees or something? Or large beams of wood or something, thinking about it out of the ground. You can see like all around the island. So what are you guys doing?
Okay, so are these creatures preventing us from rowing because they're like surrounded us, or what's...
They're not that close to you. They're in your way and a bit ahead of you. They're probably like 50 feet ahead of you or so.
Are they coming at us?
No, they're kind of crossing in front of you. But they're kind of lingering a bit.
Huh. Well, I say that we should just let them pass and see what happens.
Okay. So you guys...
There are 17 of them.
Is anyone going to try and engage them?
No.
Okay.
Nothing to do.
Okay.
I mean, we could throw a bunny rabbit at him. That's the only thing capable of that kind of attack. I think we don't have guns.
Marcus has a gun.
Marcus can...
You have one pistol that he
float.
Hardly ever gets.
He also cannot float. That's very true. He can't float anymore, can he? Because he's warforged.
No.
That's true. Two of you guys do not float. I just realized that. This is going to be this is gonna be a very interesting sea adventure. okay. All right. So they... Are you guys headed towards the island?
Well, are we going to be able to wait for these creatures to pass?
Again, if you want, you can see if they'll pass on. They appear to be kind of like milling around in the area with no particular intention to leave.
As in, they're in our way.
They're in your way. Yeah.
What if we want to keep just rowing in the same direction we were before?
You can do that.
In our way there too?
No, I mean, you can also just go around too. There's 17 of them, which is a large pack, but like you can go around if you want, right?
Okay. Well, okay, so let me just say one thing. You probably should not tell us, oh dear, there's something really terrible there, because if you didn't said that, we probably would have investigated. But because you said that, I'm not exactly sure if we want to.
True.
But
yeah.
So... Me being the mechanical person that I am, not talking about the Warforged part, but me thinking about the game mechanics, I can ignore the fact that he said that because my character didn't hear that.
Right, that's what I was thinking too, right?
Yeah. Also, I've already mentally changed something about it, so to make it fit, like, lore-wise, so, yeah.
All right. Yeah, well, I guess my suggestion is you probably want to... keep that little secret to us because it does influence us even though it's not supposed to.
Yeah.
So, okay, so we're talking amongst ourselves trying to decide.
Is there any way that one of us could roll an investigation to see what these creatures are at this point?
Now that you've all stopped and you've all been alerted to their presence, and Finnegan was just like, there's a thing!
The fish!
The fishy!
Investigation.
Yeah.
Can we eat the fish?
Nice. Oh. Minus one.
I'll roll two. Oh, I got a 24.
All right. All right, Finnegan, not Finnegan, sorry, Nomad.
Finnegan, you're going over.
You throw Finnegan over and you figure out what it is. No. So Nomad, you poke your head in underwater and just look, because you have pretty good eyesight underwater. Yeah, you're like, I'm just going to put my head underwater real quick.
I do have dark vision.
Yeah, so you can see pretty far. And you see that there is a pod of dolphins that are all milling around in front of you guys.
Oh.
Can we tell if they would be hostile or?
Right. It's...
What knowledge would our
chainsaw wielding?
I mean, you guys know what dolphins are. Dolphins are dolphins. But you also do know that the sand shrews weren't naturally aggressive either. You don't know if that was localized or if that's like worldwide
I assume we're not close enough to look into their eyes.
No, you can't tell.
Right, because that's how we would probably tell, right?
Yeah, I mean they don't seem particularly aggressive, at the moment.
So I suggest that we try to just go around them, and if it doesn't work, we try to go through them. But we probably at least attempt to go around them. That would be what I would say.
Yeah, let's head around. It doesn't seem like there's any good reason to antagonize them, and hopefully they'll stay where they're at and ignore us.
Okay. Not to try and convince you otherwise, I have no problem with this course of action, but I'm just informing you for future encounters. It does profit you to attack everything, essentially, because you do get crystal charges if they have dark essence, and you do get money regardless. So just a heads up for that. You can... It doesn't have to affect your decision. I'm just letting you know that there is a potential reason to go kill
them. I don't think it does affect your decision because we're not going to go find 17 dolphins from a boat.
Yeah,
17 is a pretty big number.
That's a large number of dolphins.
I mean, maybe four.
Yeah, but that's a lot of dolphins.
I mean, dolphins are pretty... I mean, they attack sharks, right?
I imagine we'll just jab it with an oar. It will swim away.
All they have to do is like capsize you and you're kind of screwed.
Right? Yeah, I know. That's what I was thinking. It doesn't take much.
And then you're walking the rest of the way underwater. At least half of you are.
That you mean two of us are, and then myself and the gnome are drowning.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. All right. So you guys managed to skirt around them. They seem pretty friendly. They notice you as you go by, and they kind of make some dolphin noises at you, which I will not try and attempt to do.
Squeak.
Which I will not try, he says.
And then he tried
to try it.
Yes. Yeah, so are you headed towards the island or no?
Yeah.
I say we should, because that would be our natural tendency, right?
Yeah. I mean, it lands always good, right? Especially, you know, at this point, you've been on the sea for almost all the day. You know, it's going to be getting dark soon, and so having a place to... you know, camp that's not in the middle of the ocean is probably preferred. Right.
Okay. Yep.
Okay.
So does the captain make these kind of decisions, I would assume?
Actually, technically, yes, the captain is in charge. He does make the call for where to go. So yes, captain, what is your bearing?
I say yes, head to the island.
Okay. That is a good call. I should always make sure to confirm the captain.
Right, right.
It's not actually democracy on the boat, so...
Mm-hmm. I have actually been saying the things as commands just suddenly.
Okay.
And it doesn't help that I don't have a dedicated voice for the character, but I need software.
Sound more official. Go that way. Yes.
With a little bit of a pirate accent, of course.
Yes, of course. All right. So as you approach this, you thought it was an island, it doesn't appear to be an island. It appears to be man-made, and as you get closer, you see that those kind of like small, like off in the distance, they look like small like pegs. Basically, they are large wooden beams that have people strapped to them.
Does Kevin Costner live here?
Roll for Kevin Costner check. I mean, like, do it. Give me a Kevin Costner check right now.
Oh, no.
Thank God. If you had a natural 20, I would have to put Kevin Costner on this island.
Does a high roll mean there is or is not? I don't understand who Kevin Costner is. Too young.
Too young.
You don't. Baby. Oh. Wow.
Yeah.
Waterworld, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think I ever saw the movie, though, so I'm...
As you get closer, you notice that this is a man-made structure that is comprised primarily of wood with a bit of stone, and it is a large floating platform that is quite large. It is, I mean, it's about it's almost like a full mile long, which is why you thought it was an island, and you could see it from far away. And it's like, it's definitely like the largest looking man-made structure in the ocean you've ever seen. Like, usually it'd be like a small dock, you know, near land or something, but this is definitely new. And on the sides, you see giant metal chains going down into the ocean floor. So they appear to be anchoring it in place so it doesn't float away. It may be man-made, but it has beaches, and it has like trees and foliage as well. And there is in the middle of it, there is a large building that you can see. So you guys are kind of like coming up to it now, and you're in your rowboat, and you are seeing that there. In the very front of the island and all around it, there appear to be, I mentioned these large beams that appear to be almost like crucifixion things. And there are people strapped to them, which you thought at first were people, but then realize you get closer that they're not real people. They seem to be trying to, like, they're almost like scarecrows. To try and possibly deter people or creatures, you're not sure what. And as you pull up to, there appears to be like a main beach here that you can actually like get your boat up to. And as you pull up to the beachhead, you see two armies on the beach fighting one another, but they're tiny little armies. They're only about a foot tall, and they appear to be made entirely of mechanical pieces. One side of the beach, you have these kind of spherical clockwork creatures that have kind of like knives and forks for hands. And on the other end, you have these tall, spindly clockwork creatures with hatchets and saw blades for hands. And they have, like, formations and ranks, and they have, like, different forms of, like, weapons and, like, almost, like catapults and stuff that they're, like, launching things at one another. and you see also that, like, they're actually wind-up clockwork. So, like, you'll see, like, one of their people, like, fall in battle, and he gets dragged back, and then he just gets, like, a new, like, arm strapped on, and he gets, like, wound back up and put into battle again.
Hey, Trev.
Yes.
I'm gonna make another roll, and just so you know, if it's a 20, now you have to put Tommy Lee Jones in this.
Thank God. Okay. No, Tommy Lee Jones, I'm sorry.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah, not Tommy Lee Jones. But yeah, so, and you can see that there are two leaders of these armies. They're both on, like, very obviously fake horses, because they're stick horses. They're riding stick horses. and they're in the backs, and they're the ones that are, like, calling the shots and like directing people where to go and whatnot. So yeah, what are you guys doing?
Wait, are they on opposite? Are the two leaders on like opposite sides of the field? Or are they like sitting next to each other with remote?
No, they're on opposite ends of the beach. And in order to get through the beach, this giant battle is going on in front of you guys in order to get anywhere on this island.
What is the opinion of everybody?
Oh, do we have any historical knowledge on any of this kind of the island, those clockworky things, the beings that are sitting on the
roll a history check.
I had to say it, didn't I? Okay, so
You have any history on? Well, here's a skill for that.
Well, yeah. Okay.
I got a 17.
Oh.
Anybody else?
You know what? I want to do this, and I want a bad roll.
Well,
that wasn't him.
That wasn't yours. Okay, this is no man. That's good.
Hey.
You don't want a bad roll. All right, yeah, we don't know anything. Yeah. All right, okay, so...
But I do know where to find information about it.
Oh, crap. Gosh, yeah, dang it.
You know where, but you don't necessarily...
It's not relevant now.
Yeah, it's not really relevant.
But guess what? I have something else to add to this little list of notes.
Yeah. So, this is definitely information that you would get from your home city, the same place as the other guy. Because...
The other guy...
I can't remember his name anymore. I'm sorry. You have notes on where you had gnome history, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't remember his name anymore. But yeah. Mizarth. Because your city is the one that pioneered Warforged technology, so you have a lot of experience with people who know about mechanical devices and whatnot, and. Unfortunately, all the people you know that knew this stuff are dead. So the player you know that they would be is dead. So it doesn't quite help you, I know. But
well done.
However, Nomad knows what these are from his study with some wizards. Where he was stationed for a while, because he did some research into some kind of mechanized magics back in the day, and he knows kind of like what kind, not necessarily like what specifically these are, because these are because there's a lot of different there's different kinds of clockwork creatures, because they're kind of like thrown together with parts and for all sorts of different purposes, but you gather that these are some sort of worker bots basically. And that there's probably like a workshop around here. That's probably what you surmise the the big building in the middle is. It has a whole bunch of like a big clock tower, and it has like a bunch of gears, and it has it seems to be definitely like where these things probably were built. And yet nothing specific about these ones in particular, or the island, unfortunately, at least not with the information you have to go off of right now.
Okay. So it sounds like they're... I just wonder, are they just like playing war games or something? Worker bots, huh?
So, one of the ones on the... Hold on, let me pull my notes for which one, which anymore. I don't even count that. Sorry. On the spherical side, the one with the rounder clockworks, one of their catapults, which is a spoon, with like rocks and stuff, one of their catapults shoots at you guys by accident. It seems to be it wasn't aiming at you, but you're just kind of in the area, and there's kind of things flying everywhere, and one of the like the rocks kind of like hits Weaver like kind of right in the head, and kind of like clanks a bit, and then as soon as that happens, they all just stop and just stare at you guys and have turned towards you, because they appear to have just realized that you were here, because they were pretty caught up in their little war. And they all kind of just stop and stare.
Okay, so what do the what do the two leaders look like, or what's the
there's two sides. There's basically the round ones and the tall ones, right? The round ones, their main bodies are like in a perfect sphere that has like two arms, two legs, and have forks and knives for hands, well, basically.
Right, but I meant the leaders. You already told us about the
club. Yeah, the leaders look fairly similar. They just have like a fancy hat on, and they're riding a stick horse.
But they're also small.
They're also small. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And the spherical one has a large mustache drawn on his face with a paintbrush.
So are they? So they don't really look that different. Okay. So which one sent the rock over to us? Which side? The saw blade people or the round?
The round ones. People? The round ones. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So Nomad is gonna just say, "Oh, they look very friendly. Let's go check this out. It looks like they're playing games. Shall we go find out?"
Okay, so I haven't been paying perfect attention. I've got most of the details, I think.
Okay.
Are we able to speak to the leaders from where we're at? Because the leaders...
They're a little further away, but I mean, like, the distance for you guys isn't as great as the distance is for them. So, I mean, you get there fairly quickly.
Okay, so the leaders are also tiny? I didn't catch that part.
Yeah, they're all tiny. Okay. Yeah. They're all 1 foot tall.
So
we're in the boat now, right?
Oh, you got out of the boat and you're on, like, right on the... on the beach. There's a little dock right there, basically. You got on a little tiny dock. You got out, and like there's the beach in front of you, banning like left to right, and the armies in front of you, and the leaders are on opposite sides.
Okay, so Nomad is just going to go into the. He's just gonna be reckless here and just say, he's just gonna say, "Oh, look at those little buddies! Hello, little buddies!" And he's gonna start running up to them.
To the
leader with the round spoon fork guy.
Okay.
Hello, right. Little buddy. Oh, you look like you're having so much fun. Can I play too?
He looks at you, looks all offended, and is just like, "This is not a game, sir. This is war." Playing, you say? Playing? Oh, I never.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
Those heathens over there need to be exterminated. Exterminated, I tell you, right now.
How close is it to go to the other side?
It's not too far. You can get there in like a couple of seconds, probably, if you
so
like.
So I'm just going to run over and say, almost. I'm going to just say to the other guys, "Hello, little buddies, how are you doing?"
"You appear to be in our way, sir. Would you please vacate the premises? We have a campaign to run."
"Can I help you?"
"I mean, I don't think so." "Oh my goodness, what is that?" He points it at Weaver and is just like, men, quick, over here." So, and he gathers all of his men up, he points towards Weaver, and he's just runs over and they all like milling around you a bit, and they're just like, "Oh," and they're kind of like poking you a little bit.
You better be careful, because he's very powerful. And do not make him mad.
I bet he is. Oh, he's so magnificent. How did you get so big?
Well, see, there was this day, and it started off with me being nothing, and then I got built.
Oh, us too. How was your day? Was it incredibly dark, and then all of a sudden there was just light everywhere?
Pretty much. I remember it being a tree. Multiple trees, even. And then I became a robot. It was weird.
That does sound weird. Do you have... Are you our god?
No. The gods are up there fighting. They're musical people.
That's disappointing, I have to say.
I say, can I message him? Can I message Weaver through...
I can be an envoy of the gods, though.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, very good. That was what I was going to suggest.
Oh, I see. Interesting. Good, good, good. Well, in that case, could you help us exterminate those heathens?
Why?
We've been at war for centuries, it feels like. They deserve to die.
Why not make peace?
Peace? Do you see how many of our people they've destroyed? And he points at a giant pile of scrap metal that they're, like, putting back together, like, people, and, like, and then they're pushing them back out into war.
I see how many people that you've destroyed.
Of course! Of course! That's the glory of combat! Is our crusade, our holy quest!
Well, seems like you guys are killing each other equally, if you guys both stopped.
Stop! What else would we do?
Maybe you could build something.
But we are the built. We don't build things. What does that
but
even
But you're building each other.
Like, well, yes, but that's one of our primary tasks is repair.
Who do you work for someone? Do you work for someone?
We used to work for someone, but rest his soul. He hasn't been around for quite some time. It chokes me up just thinking about it.
What was his name?
Sorry. I had a frog in my throat. I'm sorry. I was like,
oh, I do. I think I've heard a frog in my throat before.
Frog in your throat. Yeah. he was named Gawerin, and he was a wonderful man. He built all of us.
Is he still alive?
Oh no, no, not for some time.
Well, how long?
I don't know. Oh. I'm not a clock. I'm just kind of clockwork.
So what about this Gawerin? Gawerin?
Gawerin.
Okay, Gawerin. Was he a
changes every time.
Was he a human?
I don't understand the question.
What was he mechanical like you?
Oh no. Yes, he was a person. He was a person. He was a living, breathing person.
Oh. Do you know what kind of person he was?
I don't really have anything to compare. Oh, okay, he looked like that fellow over there. And he points at Finnegan. Although not quite so intimidating.
And not so chickeny?
So, yeah, I mean, I can't. I mean, he
I
had
have
a face.
No aspects of a
I mean,
chicken.
Our man had a face, so I guess not like that. I don't know.
So, did he tell you to fight each other?
No.
Were you both made by Gawerin?
Yes, of course. He made everything on the island. Even the island itself.
Why did he do that? I'm talking like you.
I don't know, actually. It never really came up.
Which one are we talking to, by the way? We talk about the fork spoon guys or the saw blade guys?
This is the saw blade guys. The tall, spindly ones.
Yeah.
What was your purpose before he died?
Well, we are kind of for construction and for building, but we kind of ran out of things to build. We need plans. We don't have any plans. And like, without plans, what are we? I mean, what are we?
Well, what if I could get you some plans?
Well, that sounds excellent.
Oh.
Okay, so here's what I'm thinking. Do I have something to write on?
Yeah. You paper and pen.
All right.
Or quill.
I would like to send a note through the, what's the holding thingy? It's not a bag of holding, it was pouch of holding.
Satchel of holding.
Satchel of holding, there we go. Mm-hmm.
It's,
to the
it's
dwarves.
A fanny pack now. To the dwarves, okay.
I want to see if they can draft up a boat.
If they can draft up a, you mean like
plans for a boat?
Oh, okay.
Oh, and have them build us a boat?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they can be our repair crew.
Okay.
Issue with this, aside from the fact that they're tiny. They cannot help much.
But there's a lot of them.
They built an island.
Oh, why don't we just ask them?
If I don't have to row, I don't have a problem with it.
I mean, okay.
You guys get really tired.
You guys do know that like ship crafting takes like years usually.
Yeah.
Talented dwarfs.
Well, they're not the ones making it either. But if you're giving the plans to them, I mean, it would give them a task for a while. That's your intention.
How many of them are there?
You know what?
I'll ask. Like
Weaver will say.
A couple hundred.
If you guys had a task, do you guys think you would stop fighting?
Well, I guess it depends. I mean, maybe. I don't. Only if they stopped first.
Okay. So.
Okay.
Weaver will go over to. Is it Sporkman?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Spork knives man. And forks. Forks and knives.
Okay, so they're separate. It's not combined.
Yeah, they're separate. Yeah.
So
hello there. Are you cavorting with the enemy?
We're not your enemy. They're not our enemy.
But they're our enemy. Our enemy's friend is our enemy. Yes.
Look.
That means.
What would it take to get you guys to stop fighting? What is your goal in this war?
Our goal is to destroy all of them.
Why?
Period. Done. Well,
Is it because you're bored?
We've been doing this for, well, I don't have a measurement of time, I'll be honest, but it feels like eternity.
How many times have you seen the sun?
A lot. I don't have great long-term memory banks, to be perfectly honest. I kind of remember last week.
Well, according to Mr. Knife Man over there, you guys were built by the same person, and you guys constructed things such as this island together.
Yes, that sounds right. I mean, we've been doing this war for as long as I can remember, but there definitely were memories of previous construction projects. Yes.
Did if I got you a construction
whole island?
I believe so. Yes. No, not me personally, of course. Maybe not even us, like our current versions. It might have been different versions, older models and all that.
If I were to give you guys a construction project, do you think you might stop the fighting?
Well, you have to guarantee that they're going to stop first.
Well, here's the deal. You can stop fighting, or you fight me. Because he wants you to stop fighting first. So, I'll just tell you that you stop fighting, and when you stop, he will stop.
Well, I mean, okay. I don't want to fight you, big man. You seem pretty tall, and kind of like a much bigger model than what we have going on over here. All right. I suppose so. But I need written confirmation from the other side first. Otherwise, no deal. No deal.
Okay.
What kind of written confirmation do you need?
We need a treaty, my good man. A treaty.
Well.
So, before I continue speaking with them, there was a workshop here, right?
Yeah, it's further up.
Would that be
the island?
Would that be something that was larger? That would be more like a person-sized thing?
Yes, it is a large building. Yeah. It is several stories tall, and I'm bad with distances, but it's several hundred feet wide. It's a big building.
Okay.
Maybe we should go check it out.
Probably, but let's get this war thing slowed down a little bit. So Weaver will go back over to...
How about a ceasefire, maybe?
Yeah. Weaver will go back over to Knife Man and be like, okay, so Spoon Man over there said that he would agree to cease fighting if you would put into writing that... I lost my wording. Dang it.
Yeah.
Okay, Spoon Man over there said that he will stop if you sign a treaty.
And by the way, I can write up a treaty for you. I can write up a treaty for you because.
But now they have stopped the aggression, and they will hold the aggression as long as you sign a treaty.
Sounds like a plot, if you ask me. But. Roll persuasion.
Yeah. Also, the way you worded that made it sound like they will continue aggression with the treaty signed.
Well.
A mighty questionable roll.
10's always an iffy number for me.
With a 10, I'm just going to pick him up and dunk him in the water.
Not really. So he seems...
Add intimidation to it, yeah.
He's... you can, yeah. You want to do that? Intimidate instead? He doesn't seem particularly convinced. He still seems suspicious and kind of just like wary of the other side. So you want to roll intimidation instead?
Yeah, sure. I should just go stomp on the other people. Oh. They're more afraid of me.
This side's not particularly convinced. They do believe that you are potentially an envoy from a deity, but they don't necessarily believe that you have a stake in this war, basically, right? So they're not 100%.
Is there anything that I can do with that?
That's up to you to find out.
What do you mean?
Like, for my deity? Like, can I show them something or do something that would...
Isn't religion a thing that you can roll for? Am I crazy?
That's to do with religion, learning about religion, though, right?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. I mean,
I do have, I think I might actually have things I could write up I could actually forge their names. I think I have that ability, if you want to do that.
Dost thou wish to engage in subterfuge and treachery?
I like this. This is good.
I'm just saying that I could not do that if you want me to try.
If it comes to that, sure.
I also
Although,
wonder if we need
the worst thing about doing that type of stuff is if they find out.
Then we're really in trouble. Yes.
Yeah, but the spindly side seems fairly unconvinced. They seem much more paranoid and suspicious. You know, they seem to think that this is a ploy from the other side.
Okay, wait. I forget which side's which now. Which one's asking for this the treaty?
Spherical side. There's spheres and spindlies. Spheres are Mr. Blustering, and the spindly one is the nasally kind of like yes.
The Britishy.
Yeah.
Which one was knives? Is it the spindlies?
No, the spheres are forks and knives, and the spindlies are hatchets and saw blades.
Right.
So I guess it's kind of knives. Yeah, but
I guess
like,
there was no knives; it was saw blades.
Yeah, it's serrated saw blades, like logging blades.
Okay, so would it do? I'm just trying to think: is it going to do any good if we had one side sign something? I'm trying to figure out. I'm a little confused about this, getting the two sides mixed up and stuff. So,
I'm gonna give you their name. So, I'll just do a kind of like a retcon post.
Yeah.
You know, introduction here. The leader of the Forks and Knives Spheres is named 777777, and his name is Captain Seven. All right, so Captain Seven of the Forks and Knives Brigade, basically. And this guy you're talking to right now, the spindly guys with like the hatchets and logging blades, is called 606 ERT, known as Robert the Fearless.
Robert
the
what?
A name.
Robert the Fearless.
So we have Seven and Robert the Fearless.
Captain
Fearless.
Seven and Robert the Fearless.
All
right. Oh, he's a captain. He really should be a part of a boat.
Okay, so.
And we're. The last one we talked to was Robert the Fearless, right? Okay.
Yep.
So, Robert, if.
Yes?
If I ask you guys to just have a ceasefire while I look around the island, would that be okay?
I mean, this is war. You can't just. I mean, if we stop.
Actually, you
shooting,
know what? It really. I guess it really doesn't matter if you guys are fighting, as long as you don't get in our way.
We will let you pass through our ranks, but there's no. I mean, we're not going to stop the war.
I mean, that's okay, right? Who cares? Let's just go. Let's just go investigate the building and see what's there. Maybe there's other people having wars or something. Who knows?
So, Weaver will go over to Captain Seven first and say, "So it looks like they're not really agreeing to terms right now. We're gonna look around the island. He's probably gonna try to fight you."
Charge! And as he runs past you on his fake horse, he says, "Oh, by the way, welcome to 1153." And he points towards the workshop, and you notice that there is a sign in front of the workshop that says "Welcome to," and then underneath that is a large clock that is stuck at 1153. The rest of the sign for "Welcome to," the rest of that has fallen off and is gone. So it looks like it says "Welcome to 1153."
Oh, I see.
So they call the island 1153.
Interesting.
And yes, it's ironic that a clockwork island has a broken clock, but shush. All right, so you guys gonna go head in towards the workshop then?
Before I do that, would this be a good point for me to suggest what my intentions are for this? Or
okay. Yeah, to us,
so basically, what I want.
Character.
Yeah, I mean, because you're walking.
Okay,
past
yeah. I guess I'm not speaking to the DM. I'm speaking to everybody.
Yeah. All
right. So here's the plan. What I want to do is I want to get all of them to stop fighting each other, and then we can tell them all to jump through our pouches and go back to our island where they can start building us a ship.
Ooh.
But how do we get back to the island?
Are you
still have our boat.
Can they just go grab him and start tossing him in your satchel? Just start drop kicking him into your pouch.
We still have our boat. We could get back there normally.
Yeah, it only took you guys a day to get here, so.
And it'll take them more than a day to build the boat anyway, so.
Okay, I say we should investigate around and see what else is here first before we do that, because. Once we put them in the pouch, they might not stay there, right? They could run around the island and do whatever they want and fight each other, and who knows what.
You're sending a bunch of armed, mechanical things to an island with just three dwarves.
The dwarves might not be real happy about this.
That's why we have to make them agree to stop fighting each other and to work for us.
Yeah, no,
which
I agree.
I think if I could perform some form of feat to make them believe in the resonator.
Yeah, okay. They were definitely intimidated by you a little bit, and they definitely saw you as like a big deal.
Okay.
Let's go to the
building first and see what's there, because they're just fighting each other right now, right? So it doesn't.
Yeah.
Just
they're back to war, and it you can clearly see that like this is going on for a long time, and
yeah, they're not going
like,
to die while we're.
They don't really die. They just kind of like get chopped up and then put back on the assembly line and then put back up to war. So like it's kind of like an endless cycle.
Yeah, right, that's why I just said, go ahead and go fighting each other while we figure out the island.
Right. Yeah. Let's just keep doing. Right. Let's go figure other things out. Right.
All right. Goodbye, Captain and Robert. All right. So you go up to this big ass building. Yeah, there's a
did
a
we get
big...
the name of their creator?
Yep. His yes, name
was that Guerin.
Guerin. Guerin.
Guerin.
Guerin. Yeah.
Guerin.
Yeah, I probably keep changing it too, so sorry. I made it too complicated. Yeah, it's G-Man. There we go.
G-Man. Okay.
Okay, so there are a... This is a large front entrance, and there is a pair of double doors. What do you got to do?
Go inside.
Yeah.
Just walking up and open the door?
We reverse.
Okay. We reverse?
Yep.
Okay. All right, Weaver, you open the doors. Nothing explodes or anything. And you walk inside, and there is a lobby with some elevator music playing. which seems weird because you were just in the middle of a little, like, war zone. And, like, it gets real quiet except for, like, this, you know, like the girl from Imanima is playing or whatever. You know, like... and it's a fairly... Like, it didn't look like much from the outside, but inside looks pretty swanky. It's a pretty luxurious looking room, at least the lobby is. You know, there's like plush red carpet, and there's like, you know, a big like ornate grandfather clock on one of the walls that's you know, still going strong. And you see, watch it here. Give me an investigation check for everybody. Perception. Oh.
Well, I rolled a 19, but my perception is probably
you're not searching for anything. You're just looking around. So
I got a 14.
Got it.
Okay, so I have to subtract 5 from what I rolled. So I got a
19, 14, 22. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, you guys see, this page is normal. Here we go. On the top near the ceiling, going from one end of the room to the other, all on the entire wall, basically on your left and your right, there are these little, like portal things, not like dimensional portal, but like even like a ship portal, you know, where you have like a little like glass mm-hmm. you know, thing
little
with a
windows.
Hole behind it. Little windows, yeah, little windows that are like blacked out though. And they appear to have like little like hinges on them in order to like open and close. There's a bunch of these. They're round, and they're only about, you know, like 10 inches or so in diameter. So they're fairly small, but there's a whole bunch of them. Like there's mm-hmm. like a good like 50, like 25 on each side basically. Up there as well. And in the very center of the room, you see a pedestal with a glass case over it, Beauty and the Beast style, where you have like the flower, right? You know,
mm-hmm.
And you see there is a clockwork bee on a little like stick that's just kind of held up. It doesn't look like it's alive or anything. It looks like a prop, but there's a glass jar with this bee inside of it. And
the bee looks mechanical or just like a piece of art?
It's mechanical. Yeah, it's made out of like little pieces of metal and gears and stuff like that. It's not moving or anything. And then at the far end of the lobby, there is a door.
Okay. Nothing else around then?
No, it's a pretty sparse... I mean, there's like a couch with like a coffee table, and there's like some reading material that is super gone and like it's definitely seen time. Paper hasn't lasted too long. It appears that like the clockworks probably used to have upkept this much better, but some things they couldn't preserve, like the magazines or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm gonna walk over to the door.
Okay.
And knock on it.
Okay. Yeah,
knock, knock, knock.
Nothing happens.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Hey guys, come on over. Let's go in this door.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. The door does not open.
Oh. Who's got the strength? Is it? Can you knock the door down?
Does anybody have a lock picking kit?
Oh, it's true.
Or would we be able to investigate?
I do. I get to be youthful. Hi.
Yes,
hi.
I forgot about you.
Me too. I forgot I was even here. Holy shit. I could just like popped into being all of a sudden. Oh my gosh. I've been like, I was in like your bag or something. It's funny.
What have you been drinking lately?
Oh, so much vodka. Yeah,
but
he
that
has.
That doesn't affect Warforged. I don't know if that's true.
Doesn't. It's special.
It's true. It doesn't.
It's nanobot.
He hasn't noticed.
All right, I don't say that aloud then.
Yeah, he has thief steel, so he can pick locks.
Yeah.
So he sits down. Not sits down. He hunches. Actually, he's short, isn't he? He's a goblin. Yeah. But he slightly bends over.
He gets a box.
He gets a box. Yeah. There you go. And he pulled out his tools and goes to work on it and is like, well, first of all, this isn't a normal lock. I'm pretty sure it's trapped.
Okay, well then go ahead and stop messing with it.
I could try and disable it if you want to, but I also might set it off.
That's
up to you.
We can try that later if we don't have a better solution.
Okay, for sure.
For now, I'm going to realize that we didn't actually roll investigation.
Okay. He just did. So, because he's messing with the lock, I'm having him roll the investigation to see kind of more information about it. So he looks, you know, he's kind of like examining the lock with, you know, like a spectacle and kind of looks at it a little bit more in detail. And he's like, well, first of all, there's a keyhole, right? I mean, because it's a door. But the key, well, it doesn't look like a normal key. I think we're looking for something that's...
Like B-shaped by any chance?
I mean... Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, maybe the back of the B? I mean, because that's round to the point at the end. So, yeah, I mean, yeah. If you want that, the finger end, that might do it.
Okay. So, I'm going to run over... Can I reach it? I'm gonna run over to the glass case.
Okay. Yeah, you can lift the glass if you want. Yeah, I won't worry about height for you because that's
okay.
Neat.
And I'm gonna try to lift.
Hold on, before you do that, did we close the door behind us?
Yeah. It self closed. It's on a little like hydraulic system.
Okay.
Uh huh.
I need to use the restroom.
Okay. I shall wait then.
Wait a minute. Elevator music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wait, hold on. I can do this actually in game. Hold on, please hold. Hold on.
What are we supposed to do with that?
I mean, you should be able to hear it. So.
I don't hear nothing.
Right click on dial-up and change its volume then. So it's louder.
Oh, I see. It's a...
It's a bot in the chat.
How do you change the volume?
Just right click on it.
Then drag the bar.
Oh, there it is.
And that'll be user volume. I have mine on 18%.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Oh, it is the what is it called? Girl from Iwo Jima or something like that.
Ipanema.
Ipanema. I can
Iwo
never
Jima
pronounce it.
Is the
the Japan, the island.
Island. Yeah. Yeah. Wouldn't be quite such a calm soundtrack, I don't think, if it was that. It's a very dark comedy.
And then it turns into Foggy Factors.
Oh, that's funny. All right. Well, if the B thing doesn't work, we'll
I'm sure we'll find some other thing. I've got identify magic or something like that I might be able to do if it's...
Well, my goal
magic.
Was actually to investigate the room as a whole for any further clues when I said that. So,
Oh, before going into the door, you mean? Yeah, why don't you just
instead of just investigating the door specifically.
Yeah, okay.
What are you doing?
Investigating the room as a whole to see if there's anything that looks like it might be a clue to how to get in the door.
Okay, go ahead, roll. No.
But
you don't see any other
see this magazine on the table, and it almost looks like it says basket weaving on it, but it's disintegrated, and now I'm sad.
Sure, yeah.
Is that something I shouldn't do, by the way?
No, that's fine. I mean, probably not, but it's fine. I mean, it doesn't matter, so it's not a big deal, but that's fine.
I assume if you said that it was... that it was basket weaving, you're going to pick it up and keep it, blah, 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 that might
be... Yeah, I mean, I'll just tell you no. I'm like, no. That's just not
okay.
Because it disintegrated, it didn't have any effect on the game.
It's,
so
it's funny, whatever.
Yeah, it's just it's good flavor.
It's good flavor.
That stuff's good. Yeah.
And I didn't have anything better to add, so that's fine. Yeah.
So, I'm trying to think of what we could actually be doing right now that would actually make sense.
Can we speak to the bee?
Sure. Why not? Right.
Okay, so you pull off the glass, and you're looking at it. You can talk to it, I guess, if you want.
Hello, bee.
Hi there. No, just kidding. No, doesn't have to talk.
Oh, why?
Okay, I'm gonna study the bee.
Okay. What does that mean?
I'm just looking at it. I'm looking at its butt.
Okay, roll investigation.
All right, hold on. Get back to
roll a butt check, actually. See if that booty fits in that hole.
Rolling for Tiny Tina.
Oh, I got a 15 for investigate.
Yeah, I mean, it looks about the right size and shape.
Okay, I'm going to go... Well, I'm going to give it to Marcus because he was such a good guy to try to...
All right, so you pluck the bee off and you toss it over to Marcus.
There you go, Marcus.
And... As soon as you remove the bee, all of those little portal things.
Oh yeah!
All of them just flap open all of a sudden, and a swarm of bees shoots out, and it goes directly towards Marcus because he is holding the bee.
Hey Marcus, you're made of metal. Don't worry.
The bees are also made of metal.
Uh-oh.
And they have little saw blades on them.
Hey Marcus, I'm wrong.
How many of them are there? Like thousands or something or what?
There's it's a swarm. There's a lot of them.
Okay.
And but you threw it to Marcus, who is next to the door. And so you don't have to traverse the space. Okay, I'm trying to figure out how to change what I had to do now. So Marcus instantly takes damage from bees.
Instantly takes damage from bees!
It's only one, though. This is good because he's Warforged. And he fumbles around with the key and tries to get it into the lock. Let's see if he can do that while being attacked by killer bees.
Oh.
Yeah.
He actually rolled something high.
He rolled high. He did pretty good. He puts the bee into the lock. He turns it and he opens the door. And he just books it. He runs in. He's like got bees all around him. So all of you guys are in the center of the room. And there's now a cloud of angry bees between you and the door because they're attracted to what appears to be the queen bee that is now in the door. So now the bees are directly between you and the door. What are you doing? They're not attacking you, but they are in the way, and they probably won't like it.
Marcus, kick the bee.
What?
Kick the bee!
But it's in the door.
Kick it! Kick it into this room.
So it's
what?
The door surrounded, opened, right?
The door opened out. Or sorry, in. right, towards you guys. They're open in towards you guys. And so now the lock side is pressed up against the wall.
Oh,
right? That makes sense.
I thought he had removed the bee.
No, he left it in. Yeah, he literally just put it in. He flung the door open. He ran inside.
I was also wrong.
So they're just hovering over around the bee, around the queen bee? Are they attacking us, or what are they doing?
You know, you're enough distance away that they're not after you right now, but there is a large swarm of bees between you and the door. They're directly in front of the door, because the door currently has the bee.
Would it be possible to crawl to the door and get the bee out of the lock?
You get to do it if it is.
I mean,
I have an idea.
The door handle is pretty high up, so what's your idea?
My idea, are these considered creatures?
Sure.
Because I could cast sleep on them and see what happens.
Okay.
What about if you used your magic hand to move the queen?
Ooh.
And I could do that. Okay, so, yeah, that's even... okay, so, I'm just trying to figure out how obvious is it that they're just swarming around the... They're just going to stay around the queen. Is that really what's...
Yeah, they're definitely like drawn to the queen, but they're... They attacked Marcus directly because he had the queen, but they're drawn to the queen, and they... You don't know if they'll attack you or not if you go through the swarm. You can try it. You can attempt to walk through if you want, but...
If we did the magic hand, whether that would do it.
They are definitely drawn to the queen.
Yeah, okay. Let's just see, I'm reading up on it to see what it does.
You're reading up on it?
On the...
Oh, Mage Hand. I was like, on my queen bee? How?
No.
It turns out the queen bee is a level 57 dragon.
Right. The hand vanishes if it is ever more than 30 feet away from me. What was that? Oh, is that the music again?
Yeah. Oh, now I can hear it.
There you go.
Oh,
this is playing for you guys, character, so in game, I mean.
Okay, so I have to stay with
this. I had the sound of bees.
Yeah, it's this and bees swarming around.
Yeah. Okay, so the question is,
you got a second bot.
How far? If I'm 30 feet away, am I? Does it look like I'm far enough away from the swarm, or is it the swarm 30 feet worth?
You have to get pretty close to the swarm. So you can do it, but you'll be pretty close to the swarm.
All right.
Because it's not like the swarm is like maintaining ranks or something here, right? Like. It's moving and fluctuating. You can probably get an angle on it, you know.
Okay, so it says you can use the hand to manipulate an object, open an unlocked door or a container. Oh, so I want to turn it to make sure we can get Marcus out.
The door is open.
Oh, the door is open. Okay.
Yeah, the door is open.
Slow or retrieve an item from an unopened container or pour the contents out. Okay, you can move the hand up to 30 feet each time you use it.
Yeah, so, I mean, since we're out of combat, you can move it pretty much, like, forever.
And is it less than 10 pounds?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a pretty light key. It's, like...
Okay, so... Less than 1 pound. I mean, this is easy, because this is just a cantrip, so I don't even have to use a spell slot for this.
Okay.
So I'm going to try doing that.
Yeah. All right.
I'm not sure if there's even a roll for this.
No, there isn't a roll. It's just Mage Hand. You grab the key with a ghost-like hand that appears out of nothing, and you're holding it. Where are you going with it?
I'm just gonna keep it away from me and slide it off to the side. You know, just
hey, Nomad,
along
maybe
the
you
wall.
Should try putting it back where it belongs.
Oh yeah, good idea. Okay, but I'm gonna try to do that, but I don't want to get close. I don't in the
yeah,
process. I don't want it to get too close to the people.
You guys are standing next to the pedestal.
Okay, so I'm gonna shout, "Hey, guys, move away from the pedestal."
We were going to go to a far point away from there.
Okay, you guys are going to back up towards the entry door. And you're going to put the queen bee back in her spot then, basically?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. You place her back on the pedestal. Are you putting the glass on it or no?
Okay, so I put on the pedestal so the mage hand's still free. So the mage hand can now pick up the glass and put it on it. Right?
Okay.
We can do
that?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going to do then.
It's not too heavy.
Okay.
About 10 pounds, I'd say, probably. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
It's fine.
Yep.
I mean, it's a little awkward because...
It's one-handed.
It's one-handed, yeah. So, I guess... maybe you can change the size of your hand. I don't know. Sure.
We'll I know.
Or you can it just like says... palm. You'll just palm like a basketball. That's fine.
The description is not very clear.
Yeah, it's not great. That's right. Yeah.
The things it can do. Things that it can do, like if it can open a container, that's a two-handed thing.
Yeah, it is.
So somehow it can do it. You know.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. We'll face. Whatever. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, when you put the bee back and they all still are swarming around the bee in the mm-hmm. center of the pedestal, you close the case off with the glass, and the bees retreat back into where they came from.
Yay! Well, Weaver, that was a very, very good idea. Thank you very much. I had not thought of that.
You're welcome.
All right. So. You guys going into the next room where Marcus is at?
Yep.
Okay.
I think one of us should stay outside.
Okay.
Why? In case the door closes on us.
well, it does seem easiest for the one with Mage Hand to get the door back open.
There is a handle on the inside of the door.
I'm gonna test it first, though. Make sure.
Yeah, it looks like it's a one-way lock. You can open it from the other side.
Okay, we'll go in. Okay, very good.
Yeah. are you closing the door or leaving it open?
Probably be good to close it if we can easily open.
Yeah, let's close it.
Okay. Alrighty. So you enter. A room, a large, very sparsely decorated room, and there is a large pit in the middle. And around the pit, there is a ring of runes that are all glowing.
Runes or rooms?
Runes, R-U-N-E-S.
Okay.
Okay, can you say this again? So there's a large pit,
And there is a circle of runes around the edge of the pit.
Like on the floor or
written on the floor surrounding the pit. Okay. There are glowing symbols. And you hear sobbing coming from the bottom of the pit.
I'm gonna go look at it.
Okay. Roll which investigation.
Is, which is awkward given the mask, but whatever, I can see, promise.
Roll investigation, sir.
My name is me, and I always forget my modifiers.
I printed mine out because I just didn't want to have a whole screen for
okay.
that.
I got a modded 20.
Yep. A dirty 20. Alright, so, Finnegan, you see at the bottom of the pit appears to be a human child. And they are in dirty rags, and they are curled into a little ball.
This bring bad omen.
Okay, one child?
And we're leaving.
One child. Okay. One child.
Marcus, get the gun.
Oh, come on.
What? You want...
Don't give me any ideas.
Want me to shoot the kid? And as you guys are kind of like, moving around and kind of talking a little bit, you know, you hear
a
voice come.
A kid down there.
You hear a voice come up. Hello? Hello?
Hold on. Let me make a quick aside. Whenever I roll an investigation check and have to, in character, reword what you just said, I feel like the best way to do it is just to be a retard pointing out the obvious. Hey, there's fish! The baby! Okay, continue.
Hello? Can someone help me?
This is a you thing, Nomad.
Yep.
Is anybody gonna come get me?
Oh, the poor thing.
I've been here for so long.
We need to help it. How far down?
You're right.
Is the
you
pit?
Do need to help it, Nomad.
How far down is the pit?
It's about 40 feet.
Oh, gee. Okay. Well, I'm not gonna jump.
If I were to roll for Arcana, would that be something that would be useful for the rune thingies?
You can try. Yeah.
I think we're starting to get the hang of some of
this.
Nope. Yeah, it's indecipherable. You're not familiar with this spell, but there is a spell cast on this. You can tell.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm just going to talk to the child. Right? You only just talk to the child and see what the child knows. It might not even be real.
Probably isn't.
Although, hello, child.
Maybe
what
Weaver
your
wouldn't
name?
Know that.
What is my your name, child?
My name's George. Are you going to get me out of here?
We don't know how.
Well, I mean, don't you have rope or something?
How did you get there?
Well, it's kind of a long story. I don't really want to talk about it.
Pardon how me. Long have you been there?
I don't really have a way to measure time in this pit. I don't know.
Okay. We could just try the rope thing. It seems a little too obvious, though. Let's see here. Yeah, probably doesn't help. I could, you know, do one of these detect magic things that would tell me what kind of magic it is.
That would be good.
I can see if it's a magic imbued. Imbued? How do you pronounce it? Imbued. I can't
imbued.
Say it.
Imbued.
Object.
Yeah, imbued.
I can learn its properties. I'm not sure if this is an object or not, the glyphs. Because I have this. Apparently, my scribe's insight and stuff like that doesn't tell me if it's. It says the spell doesn't decode secret messages. So I'm assuming this might be a secret message. If it's just written in a language, I could probably read it, though. I think I should try to do that. I don't know. There's so many different ways to go here.
I feel significantly...
Well, I think the best route would be to figure out what is going on, like what the runes are.
Right, but how would
I don't
do
trust
that?
A little kid that's been in a hole for
an
amount of
time.
What have you been eating all this time, George?
Whatever I could find. There's been a couple rats. I had to eat those.
Yeah, right.
And
on an
know,
island.
Other food as well.
What other food?
Occasionally some like mold grows and I eat that.
Yeah,
other
right.
other people food, you know.
Other people?
No, not I don't eat other people.
Marcus, get the gun.
is there anything laying around that we can just throw down in the pit?
No. It's smooth stone.
Nothing in the walls or anything, huh?
Nope, it is it's just the floor is stone and the walls are stone. It is a smooth stone room.
We could just use the rope.
Yeah,
that's
somehow
too easy.
I get the idea if we do that.
There is also a door at the end of the hallway. Or the end of the room, I should say. The hallway.
I need to turn off the AC. I'm so needy.
Oh, there's another door.
Hmm?
Sirs, are you gonna come get me?
We're working on a plan. Don't worry, George.
Okay. I'll be here.
Okay.
I guess.
I think maybe we should go to the next door rather than waste our
returned.
Okay.
I think we should go to the next door because if I, you know, I don't want to use up all the spells and stuff now in case we need it for fighting something later. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it is getting late, isn't it? Do we need to
No.
Okay.
Not really.
I got another 20 something minutes.
This hasn't taken too long.
In
real world?
No, I meant in the D&D world.
Yeah, D&D world. I mean, like, this hasn't taken too long to do all this stuff.
Oh, okay.
It'll take, like, infinity.
Let's check the other...
One of our plans for getting to this island was to rest, right?
Yeah.
So,
but you
probably are at a point where we could use a rest, so maybe...
Yeah, but you got a couple hours.
I don't think we're going to sleep here, though. That's kind of creepy.
In this room?
Yeah. I say we try to go through the next door. What do you guys think?
We haven't investigated the room as a whole yet, have we?
Oh, that's true. Okay, well, look around the room then.
I mean, there's nothing there. I'm gonna make you guys roll for this. There's nothing there.
Okay.
Literally nothing. Yeah. It's just a pit with a bunch of runes around it and a small child bottom of the pit.
I'm guessing it's just a plain old trap.
Well, Nomad, do you know anything about these runes? Have you studied them?
Well, I guess I could at least look at them and study them using my standard, whatever it is you use to look at runes for.
Arcana.
Okay.
Whatever.
So yeah. should I do Arcana check here? Okay. I think it's this one.
Yeah.
Ooh, natural 20 plus 5.
Hold on, I have to look something up.
And we win the game.
Level 20.
I have to find out what the heck this is called. Yeah.
It's written in the Ni language.
Yeah. I didn't actually plan for this 100% for the specific spell. I can't find the exact one.
Okay, actually, just wing it.
But yeah, it's a higher tier variant of the hold creature spell.
Oh. And do I know what hold creature spell does?
Yeah, I mean it means that it cannot cross it, or the creature contained within it cannot cross the boundaries of it. But this one appears to have a variant that it cannot cross itself, but it can be helped across by someone else.
And this is what the runes are telling me?
No, this is what the runes state, basically, in whatever the rune language is, yeah. in Elvish or whatever. This because the way that it's written out, kind of like what the spell does.
Okay, because I think I do know Elvish too, by the way.
Okay.
Okay. So.
As do I.
Yeah. So okay. So, but runes are not necessarily the same.
It's not. Language, yeah. It's Elvish symbols, not Elvish language.
Yeah. 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 Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what do you guys want to do? You want to actually try to get this guy out or not? It's just awfully suspicious. What's he going to turn into?
I don't trust him, but when we got the bee, a whole bunch of bad things happened. I imagine that he might be some sort of key for the next door, and then something bad would happen. Maybe we could ask him.
Okay, go ahead.
Hey, kid, are you a key for this door?
What? I don't think so.
He didn't say no.
Do you know how to get through the door?
What door?
There's a door over here.
Oh, it's been so long, I've forgotten. Have you tried opening it?
No.
Okay, well,
we're afraid it could kill you.
Oh, well,
but we're gonna do it anyway. No.
Oh God! Oh, oh God! Oh, why would you do that to me?
I'm just kidding.
Oh. All right. That's a great joke, mister. Thanks.
Alright. So what do you want to do, Weaver? What do you want to do? Then again, I'm thinking we should just try the door and see what happens, but it's
my
lock.
We could check the door.
Yeah, let's check the door. Is it locked?
No.
Oh, there you go.
You going through?
Yes.
I think we should. Are we all going? Alright.
You all going? All right.
Yes, we're going.
All right. So you walk through the door and leave
George
the child in the pit, and he goes, "Sirs, come back."
We ignore him.
Okay. All right.
Close the door. Use the rope to tie it. Pull out a welder and seal it.
Throw a grenade down there.
Oh.
That's the
bot. Oh, that's the bot.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Alright, and you are in the next room, where there are two animated suits of armor playing catch with
is
one another.
Is there another child pretending to be a ball?
No. But there is a fairly large black glowing sphere that they are using to play catch with, and each of them is equipped with these pretty intricate and like dope ass looking gloves that they're using to throw this ball back and forth. There is like a playing field that they have constructed. You're not sure what kind of game this is. It looks a little bit like tennis / catch / dodgeball. The rules aren't really clear. They seem to be pretty simple, where they're just kind of just tossing at one another. Doesn't seem like a great game, but you know, whatever. there's these animated suits of armor that are playing catch. And when you enter the room, they stop, and I need to have a voice for suit armor. No, they can talk. Yeah, no, they say, "What ho, traveler? Care for a game of what's the dingus? It's the name of the game we invented called What's the Dingus?"
It's quite fun. You know what? Give me a second. I want to watch you guys play so I can learn the rules.
Oh, no problem. We can actually explain them to you right now. So what we do is we just throw the ball back and forth. It's very simple. It's very simple. And if you win, you can pass and go to the next door. You can go to the next room. All you have to do is beat us at this game.
How do you win?
You win by having your opponent get touched by the ball. That's all you have to do. Just touch them. Simple, right?
With the ball.
The ball. You throw it at them, and you touch them.
But if they catch it, then they're touching the ball.
Yeah. Well, not with the glove. You hit them with the ball. And they can't catch it. It defeats the purpose.
It's like dodgeball.
It's
dodgeball.
Sure. Yeah, it's dodgeball rules, basically. Okay. I mean, they don't have dodgeball, but yes, it's dodgeball.
Medieval dodgeball.
But it's like 1v1, though. 1v1 dodgeball with one ball. So
finally something I can do as a master of the body arts.
Are you guys gonna play?
I'm gonna play.
Hey, go ahead. Want to check out the room first. Like, is what? There another door?
There's a door behind them, but it's behind this playing field.
Does it look like the only thing in this room is really the playing field?
Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, like benches and whatnot, but yeah, it's the playing field is the centralized piece in the room and seems to be like the most prominent feature, and everything else is like accessories for it, like, you know, like there's a little like net, and you know, in the middle it goes across, and there's like a water cooler off to the side, which is weird because they're not like alive, so why would they need water, but it's there.
This is bizarre.
What happens if we lose?
Well, you know, fun things happen.
What kind of? I'm afraid things? You'll need to be a little more specific.
Well, you see, this isn't just a normal ball. And he picks up. He's throwing the ball in the air.
If you touch it, you get disintegrated, isn't it?
Everybody, roll a history check.
History.
I forget the name, and I also forget the dungeon, but I know exactly what I'm thinking of.
Uh-huh.
I don't like it. Ooh. I have no modifier.
I got
apparently,
nine.
Apparently Weaver is going to explain to us what that ball is.
Yeah, okay. So, this is a Sphere of Annihilation. This is a hole in the multiverse that they're just casually throwing around like it's a baseball. If this touches you, you are disintegrated and you die instantaneously.
The whole you, not just part of you?
The whole you. Yes. This is a fairly famous artifact. There were not many of them created because they were horrific. and they are basically a weapon of mass destruction. Like, they're playing catch with a nuclear bomb.
I don't wanna.
However, you do know also that there is a potential when being touched by this that you won't die, but you'll go to a different dimension or a different time, because it controls space and time, and it's a tear in the universe. So, like, either you'll be ripped apart entirely, or you'll be teleported somewhere else, or it's entirely chaotic.
Hey, you guys said you use gloves, right? Like, to hold that thing?
Indubitably, sir.
Can I just have a glove and hold it real quick just to see the weight?
Of the ball or the glove?
The ball.
Oh, when they're holding the ball, they're not actually touching it with the glove. It is hovering in the glove. The glove appears to be emitting some sort of energy that kind of encapsulates it and makes it safe for them to hold.
Well, like, that ruined my
energy
plan.
Energy field.
What were you thinking?
I was going to ask to hold it, and I'm just going to hit him with it.
Oh, got it.
I was totally going to cheat.
Well, you could still do that, couldn't you?
Yeah. Well, considering it hovers, it technically has no weight in my hand, and it makes the question moot.
You also know that these are not... They have infinite mass, and you can't throw them, per se.
What do you do?
But they're seem to be throwing around just fine. So they'll explain to you that they are using magic to move the sphere back and forth, and not actually throwing it, per se.
Oh, well, there goes my whole body perfection thing.
But they are catching it with the glove, because these are special gloves. These are artifact gloves that can touch anything. These are the gloves of Zoltur, which you got a dope ass history checked, which were used in order to make spheres of annihilation originally, in order to actually hold them.
Right.
Not much use to. Yeah, I mean, because, like, it's not super practical to have to use magic constantly to transport things, so to have a device that can actually hold them is very helpful.
Should we write down what they were called, or doesn't it really matter?
Yeah, well, you'll see.
How many of them are around?
What, the spheres or the gloves?
The gloves.
You don't know. Not a lot, that's for sure.
In the room.
Oh, in the room? There are two gloves.
They're being used right now?
Yeah, each of the suits of armor has a glove, and they were tossing back and forth. So they would like force push it back to force push it over to one of them, and then one of them would catch it with their glove, and they'd reverse it basically. So they have one hand that's pushing, with magic, and one hand that's catching it with glove.
So if we were to play this game, would we be like wearing the armor or something, or what? I mean,
I think we'd just be wearing a glove.
Yeah, they give you a glove. So you each be given a glove of Zoltur, there aren't two gloves. There's two pairs of the gloves. My mistake, because they both have two gloves on. So they'll each loan you a glove. So this will work. Is they're gonna break you off into pairs, and one of you will push the sphere, and one of you will catch the sphere, and one who catches the sphere has the glove. Right, so put your magic person on the push, and put your dexterous person on the catch. And you can distribute the teams however you wish.
So you have two people on each side, is that what you mean?
Yeah, yep.
And whoever loses is annihilated, so we lose half our people.
Well, technically it only hit the person catching the sphere.
Okay, we lose one of the three people.
Yeah,
one of the four of us. That's not a very. I don't think I like those. That solution. I mean, that's what you're saying. If we actually go along with this, then we would actually lose somebody, right? That's what.
I mean, to your knowledge, based on the knowledge of the sphere.
Do the armor guys have names?
No.
Okay.
They don't. Mm. Yeah, they're
hey,
not.
Armor guys, would you mind if you let all four of us use the gloves real quick?
Well, I guess. I mean, sure. Here, try them on.
So our party currently has all of the gloves?
All two of them.
Wait, okay. Can we whisper?
Well, there's
so
a total of four gloves, right?
Yeah, what? There are four gloves total.
Two pairs of gloves?
There's two pairs, yeah. I misspoke earlier. Oh. There are two pairs, not two gloves. Yes. Okay, so we all are trying them on.
So each have one glove, is what you're saying.
Do they fit his little gnome hands, or are they big?
Yeah, they have straps. That
my question is, do we have all four at the same time?
Yes, we...
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because, okay. So, I guess they don't have any power now.
Why don't we just walk through the door now?
Well, the door is locked, is it not?
We haven't tried.
Yeah, you haven't tried.
Of course, if we try, then they'll know that we tried.
What? I want to look up the gloves so bad, but that's cheating.
Well,
I
want to
see if I can use it for
I'm at mom, so.
Oh. Trev, tell me how I can use this to power game. Come on.
But they are an item that I did create and exist in D&D Beyond that if you're able to secure them, you can keep them. If.
So we are not in control of them.
Well, I mean, you currently have possession of them, but like if you just run away, like they're going to try and stop you, right?
The armor people. The armor guys.
Okay. Yeah. Because they said they'll let you pass if you play their game.
Uh-huh.
I mean, is there anything stopping us from just killing them with the orb?
I mean, you could try.
There's only one orb, right? How many orbs are there?
Yeah, there's one orb.
So if you threw it at one of them, then and if it happened to annihilate him, you still got one left.
My only concern is they might have more control of this room than we realize.
Mm-hmm. And we're looking. I'm looking around. Do I see anything else of interest here?
Not particularly. Okay. No. Yeah. This is all just sound like the playing field.
I did think that there's a possibility that George might actually have something to do with this, but you know that you actually have to, whatever George is that we actually need George to be able to do this, but. I don't know.
It is a possibility.
Oh my.
Well, I guess I'll leave it up to you guys to decide this one.
Well, you get any ideas? That's the. And we're not going to play the game because one of us is going to die.
Not if you get
not if we catch it.
Yeah, not if you actually
throw it once. Oh, you just throw
it. Okay,
one.
So the way it works is you throw it at them, and then you will have a chance to hit them. And then if you don't hit them and they catch it, then they have a chance to throw it at you, and then you have to roll it to catch it. So you will have the first throw.
And
so if you roll high, I mean hit them, then they're out.
Both of them?
Well, you have to individually. You have two pairs, so you each have to do it.
Right. All right, I have an important question.
Okay.
This would be a regular... Would this be an AC check when they try to hit us? Or what would it be?
Nope. Dexterity. Okay, so when you throw the spheres, you will do an Arcana contest to hit a certain marker to see how well you throw it.
Arcana?
Well, that's why you'd be the catcher, not the thrower. Right? You have a magic user at the Arcana contest, and then you have a catcher that has a dex contest, right? And then you have a chance to dodge. Okay? So you throw, then they dodge. Okay? And with a dex save.
Russian roulette here.
Yeah. And hold on, let me put my notes here. Yeah, so each time you throw, there's an attack roll, you know, with a DC you have to hit, and then they have a dex save they have to hit in order to get out of the way, basically, or catch So.
Okay. This is going to be our last thing before we quit here.
Yeah. You currently have all four gloves. If you want to just, like, try something bananas, you can do that.
Can we fight these guys? Does this work? Hold on. Thing is, we might have to come back through again. Well, I had one idea, is we actually play their stupid game. Maybe I could cast grease on them, you know, the butter blaster thing, so it's slippery for them.
So I imagine the dexterity saving roll would not be affected as an attack roll type thing? Or would it?
In what context?
I was thinking that I could use Bane, which makes target must roll a d4 and subtract the number rolled from an attack roll or saving throw. Or
saving throw. So it's so a it dex save. It's a dex save to dodge or catch. So
okay, so this would be good.
Well, who's gonna but you're not the catcher, you're the thrower probably, right?
No, but he got Bane on them, so they'd have a negative d4 on their dex save when they try and catch or dodge.
Got it. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, you guys can cheat.
right.
I mean,
I'm going to leave it up to somebody else if we try to just annihilate them now without doing anything or without them having a fair fight. But
the only two people who can do that are you and Nomad, because you're the only two that can actually throw this thing. You kind of have to just make a call if you're going to do that or not.
Do what?
If you're going to use the orb or the fear of annihilation, like just right now, like just at an attack.
Oh. So you're saying we could just pick up the ball right now and throw it at them.
Yeah. Because they don't have gloves. Because you took all their gloves.
So hope you don't miss.
Yeah. So that means that you just roll an Arcana contest and hit a DC and they don't get a dex save.
Yeah, I think that's better odds, right?
But if you do that, you may be in combat instead of playing the game. But it's up to you.
I mean, playing the game is essentially in combat anyway.
Yeah, more or less.
Well, the intentions are different.
Yeah.
Well,
so Marcus huddles down. You guys kind of huddle down together, trying to like with your gloves, like testing it up, and kind of like huddle down, and kind of like figure what you guys are doing. Mm-hmm. And Marcus comes up and is just like, "What if we use it on the door? What if we just like blow it up?"
That's a good idea.
Cheating, Marcus.
Like just be like, "Oh, look over there!" And we just go poop, and just just blow out of it.
Where does this? I'm not sure how this sphere thing works.
But it sounds fun.
Would it annihilate the whole room? Would it annihilate us? How is this?
You don't know. Probably not. I mean, it's based on touch and contact.
Okay.
So, I mean...
And then we have the sphere in the next room we got to go into, right?
And two angry animated guardians.
So we'd still have to fight them, right?
Well,
but they wouldn't be able to. I'd rather fight them than have to do the stupid,
but we don't know how strong they are. But we could also go into combat controlling the core, or was it a core? What was it called?
Sphere.
Right, and we would probably still have, if the sphere goes in the other room, at least whoever gets there first gets the sphere, and they can't pick it up because they don't have the gloves. So Marcus, that's not a bad idea.
Well, thank you.
I think they would become hostile if we attacked the door with it, so
yeah,
I think
would.
We should just attack them first, and then we could use it on the door.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so you're going to You gonna attack one of them? Okay. Yeah, which one of you?
Do we have time to pick up the ball? Just pick up the ball and then throw our spells or anything like that? Can we do that?
So
how's this work?
Yeah, you didn't do what I thought you were gonna do. This is gonna be out of combat, and if you're going to do another attack, that's one of your abilities that will start initiative. So you will not be in initiative until after we have resolved this, basically. So do this first. Can we make it look like an accident?
If you roll high enough.
Yeah, you could try.
Would it still just be an Arcana check, or?
Yeah, I mean, you still have to launch this thing. You still have to hit them first. So, I mean, what it looks like when you're doing that, you know, like what your body pose is or whatever, and like your expression is or whatever, that's, you know, that's up to you.
Well, what I want to do is I want to pull out my butter and say I'm hungry, and
slice
a little butter and throw it down at them, and it's only a 10-foot radius. Are they within 10 feet of each other?
Yeah.
Yeah, right now, throw it at them, but far enough away so we don't have to, right? We're not affected by it because we're further than 10 feet, I assume.
Okay.
And I want to kind of do that and then have Weaver pick up the ball and throw it at them. Can we do all that in one
also,
turn?
Also, if you want, you can both do the ball and you'll get advantage on the attack roll because
we both throw the ball. Is that actually possible?
Well, you can both. Well, because you're mentally pushing the ball with magic. You can both push it together.
Okay, yeah, we can do that.
Since you're not playing by the rules,
right? We can do this all in one turn before they get a chance.
Yeah, I would. I'll allow the butter blaster because it's not an attack. It's not an aggressive attack that would not start combat. So you can do.
And
you
what
can
about?
Throw the butter.
And what about his dexterity? What was it called? Bane or whatever?
It doesn't matter. They don't have a dex save.
Okay.
They don't have gloves. Actually, so therefore you wouldn't need to grease it either because they don't have a save.
Yeah, but
they wouldn't be able to dodge it.
They don't. No.
Okay. Well.
This is just an attack roll via Arcana check.
Yeah, but we only hit one of them, right?
Yeah.
Well, and the other one's still gonna be around. Oh, but he can't pick it up.
I mean, unless you are gonna go try and get an angle on them to like get them lined up or something.
Well, would it actually go through one into the other?
You don't know.
Okay. well, sure. Okay, so so I'm thinking what we do is I do still throw the grease thing because if this doesn't work, at least that gives us an advantage.
Okay, fine. It's a non-aggressive action. So they're not gonna like attack you for that.
Right. And then we pick up the ball and we walk around first before we all do this. We walk around. Is there a direction that we can be that would actually hit them both if we start?
Yeah, I mean they're standing side by side in front of you, and the ball is like it's currently hovering in the middle of the field between you two. So like they're in front of you side by side, and you're lined up basically. In front of the ball. So you'd have to go around to the left or right and bring the ball with you in order to do that. And you're going to try and do that like sneakily somehow?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
like,
well,
is someone going to distract them? Or like, I mean, they're going to notice that you're just like moving the ball around like in like a weird direction.
Hey, Finnegan, asking him questions.
Hey, robot, armor man.
Yes, sir.
Do you know the time?
I do not, but I believe it's always 11:53 around here.
So as he's doing all that, now we're trying to see.
Hey, Mr. Mr. Armorman.
Mr. Armorman with my father. I am Sven. I'm a Sven.
Hey, can I wear you?
What? Oh, good lord. Ugh, this little meat sack inside me.
Yeah, you're not so hot yourself, tin boy.
I beg your pardon. So what are you doing as they're doing that?
Sneaking around.
So we're sneaking around, trying to get to the ball.
All right, so you will have to roll an Arcana check to move it at all. It won't be as high a DC because you're not throwing at a target. You're kind of just dragging it, but you do have to do one.
Rolling?
Yeah, you can do an advantage. Yeah, so both roll Arcana.
Okay.
So, like, do you just, like, pour oil on your joints, or what do you do?
12 for me.
15. Okay, that's not bad. Yeah, it's 10. I mean, the DC would be 10, okay. Since it's you're not throwing in or anything. Okay, so, yeah, you guys, if anyone's distracting them with questions, roll a stealth check. Both of you guys.
Oof. Can I cover them up with a little bit of persuasion? Or intimidation? Or charisma, even?
Possibly.
Alright, they... not... 11.
Yeah, so they're beginning to turn towards Weaver and Nomad. What are you doing?
I'm gonna roll a charisma check.
Okay.
Wait, hold on, let me check.
Or persuasion, or
We gotta quit here soon here, too.
So all my modifiers are awful.
Okay.
11.
Okay.
Hey, how do you get these muscles? I'm just kind of pointing it vaguely at his arm.
Okay. So you and Marcus, because Marcus catches on what you guys are doing, they're not particularly bright, and you guys continue to distract them as Nomad and Weaver pull the Sphere of Annihilation off the side a little bit, and kind of like, you guys are kind of like, you know, kind of like stretching and just like, yeah, you know, just kind of like you're testing out stuff and whatnot, right? Go, all right, you get it lined up.
And I'm doing the Butter Blaster.
Okay. Yeah, they don't notice.
Do I need to?
You don't need to do an attack or anything. Yeah, they're just butter on the ground.
Okay. Right, so now roll Arcana.
Roll Arcana, both of you guys. We're all good.
Okay, hold on. I think I gotta use spells left.
Okay.
Yeah. Hold on.
That's not good. Just gonna put it out there. That's definitely not good.
So my Arcana is... Here we go.
Ooh.
21.
There you go. Okay. Yeah. So, Weaver, you begin to try and push the orb of the Sphere of Annihilation, and it begins to move towards you, not away from you. And then Nomad steps behind you and pushes as well, and it shoots out towards both of these suits of armor, and they turn their heads towards you and it just goes through both of them, and all they right. just disintegrate, and they just like warp out of existence.
Woohoo!
Yay!
Yeah.
So does it stop at some point?
Yeah, you only pushed it. I mean, I assume you didn't throw it like hella far.
I wasn't sure how this worked, if it just kept going or.
No, it's kind of like has like, weirdly a magical gravity to it. Like, so it'll just like go for a distance and then just stop in midair.
It's the same problem as ghosts. I mean, how come ghosts don't fall through the floor, right?
Right, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it has a suspension, like, magic that keeps it up. And right. it you had to, like... it wasn't the air you were throwing it through. It was, like against its own natural, like, gravitational pull.
So it's like that one sport with the rock on the ice that I'm forgetting the name of. Curling. Wait, is it curling?
Curling.
Yeah.
Are you gonna, like, move, thing. Like, the stuff around it to make it move? Yeah, kind of like yeah. that. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah, I know.
I need to quit here, so.
I know, but I have a paragraph left, and then we're done. So.
Oh, okay, fine.
So I'm gonna get you guys at the door here because I'm gonna have it unlock. Because the lock was tied to them, and they don't exist anymore. So.
okay.
I'm gonna say that go ahead and kills the lock on it because mm-hmm. yeah, they're out of signal range. Essentially. So, upon entering the final chamber, you see that there is a large workbench with various tools and materials all strewn about on it. There is what you recognize as a teleportation ring in one corner that is cracked and broken and singed, and definitely not usable or in commission, and several of the runes are just missing. And inside of that is a pile of charred ashes with a pair of spectacles on top of it. So go ahead and roll investigation, y'all.
Investigation. My name is, I keep forgetting. Okay, yeah, that is the right modifier. Also,
and we ran a zero. Oh my crap.
We okay. got distracted I got again.
All right, good. That's fine. That's actually, that's appropriate. So we, so Nomad, you go over and you poke the charred ashes, and you, which you assume is the master of the house that they were talking about. This is an office, right? And a work site. There is, you know, like papers and whatnot turned about.
G-Man's ashes?
Yeah, this is his ashes. You take it. There's like a little like G inscribed on like the spectacle on the side. You look at the glasses and you notice peeking out of the ashes, there is a glint of metal. And you reach into the ashes and you pull out a metal sphere that has a lot of gears and patterns and symbols on it. And in Elvish on the side, around like the middle of the sphere, actually, there's some terminology you are not familiar with. You speak the language, but you don't necessarily understand what these terms are, because they're kind of like scientific terms. But you do piece together that the words equivalent exchange and path of the artificer, there's a bunch of gears and a bunch of it's almost like formed like a Rubik's cube, right? So it has like different ways it can turn. The sphere does. There's like different ways that it can, like, as you pick it up, you kind of feel like it has a little bit of like give to it. You can turn it in different directions. are you doing anything with this?
First of all, hey, look, you guys, look what I found. I found a spherical thingy. I'm gonna start. This is my nature. I'm just gonna start trying to move it back. You know, whatever you like. You solve the Rubik's cube. You know how you twist it and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I'm
tinkering with it. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So you twist it around. You kind of just fiddling around, just like, oh, whatever. But then, like, you feel like your hands are starting to do something of their own accord, and they twist it in a way you weren't even thinking about, and something clicks all of a sudden, it begins to glow, and then you feel like you're being drained of power as you're holding this thing. Pulling your power into it, and sucking it in.
I'm scared.
As well as some of your memories as well. Some of your, like, your magical memories of different spells and whatnot. It is eating those spells, and you are losing the memory of those things. Then after this is finished, that feeling reverses and something's being shoved into you, basically. Some force and power being shoved into you. And as this happens, your vision goes black, and then you see a vision of a giant floating clockwork castle in the sky. And then you see the old style of Warforged before they were made sentient, like the old style, before Weaver. You know, the old automaton style that didn't have soul, they didn't have anything other than just marching orders. You see them being produced there in a factory line. A lot of them are being produced there in a factory line. And then you're back into the real, back to the real world. And you feel inventive. Yeah. So, you've had...
I'm shaking my head.
Yeah. So, for clarification for everybody else, he has lost a level in the wizard class, but he has been given a level in the artificer class. So he
I just
now...
have to imagine that this whole time Weaver has either been asleep or just staring at like the hinge of the door.
Just looking at another wall.
Just like, that's not interesting. Because you rolled a zero, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna give you something to do then. Because yeah. Okay. So, Weaver. You while all this is happening, you're off in the corner, and you found this like, this cool clockwork bird, that like when you poke it in the beak, it like squeaks at you, and you're just super entertained by this. You're just like over and over, just like boop boop boop, honk 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 honk, and you're just like, wait, what was that?
That seems fitting.
Yep. And yeah, that is where we will leave it for the evening.
And what was Finnegan doing during this?
What did you roll, Finnegan? You rolled not too bad. Yeah, you were rummaging around in the desk, looking at some paperwork, and trying to decipher some of like the plans and structures. There are some definite plans of the island. Some like older plans that you can definitely tell that were locked away of the structure. And you know, there's a bunch of plans for like devices and like modules that you have no idea what they're for or what they do. There's some that seem to appear to have very large weapons on them, but you don't really know what that is.
plans for weapans, not the weapons.
Yeah. Okay. Well, there's plans for weapons, and there's plans for like basically like tank-like things, and there's also plans for little tiny things, like little like pocket watch things with like little like things coming out of them and whatnot. It's a whole bunch of these things in there, pretty much.
Okay, so when we come back, we're gonna be investigating this room more probably.
Probably, yeah.
Sorry, and is there another door?
Nope. This is the final room.
Back the way we came then.
Yeah, this is a large
bees and all that stuff.
Yeah, this is a large circular room that has a big glass dome on the top of it that has like a telescope and all that stuff. And there's
Let's
like
stay here.
Are you guys gonna, I mean, it's gotten late, it's getting dark outside. Are you guys just gonna camp for the night basically?
Seems like a good idea. Here?
It doesn't seem
sounds like
yeah.
a real good idea, yeah.
I mean, there is like there's an actual like bedroom on the second floor.
Oh, cool.
That has like a bed and there's right. like a guest bed too and all that stuff. So like, I mean, two of you are Warforged and don't need to sleep in a bed or anything. So two beds would be sufficient for the biologicals among you.
Well, and I don't actually need a bed probably either.
I guess that's probably true. Yeah, that's probably true. Yeah,
I think about it.
Well, I mean, it might help you fall asleep better, but yeah. Other than
yeah,
that,
that's right. Yeah. It would. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I gotta go, guys.
Yep. Okay.
Thanks.
Yep.
All right, see you.
Night.
Happy Father's Day.
Yeah, so he just gave me a Father's Day present.
Oh, shoot. Oh, shoot. Hold on. No, I forgot. Hold on. No, there's one more thing. It's the bird. Sorry. It's the bird that Weaver's poking in the face.
Okay.
Yeah. So the clockwork bird that Weaver poking in the face, after a while, it hops up and it flies out the window.
Oh, birdie.
Yeah, and then you guys kind of go off and look at, you know, look out the window as it goes out. And you see an actual bird.
As in a hawk?
No.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
Not a hawk. Okay. But you see an actual bird that is flying outside as well. And it's flying past. It appears to be quite large, like it's a pretty impressive wingspan. Everybody, roll nature check.
Nature.
So I'll be real. I'm just tired right now. I've just been looking at animals trying to fall asleep.
Okay.
And it's getting contagious.
Nomad? Did you
I'm
roll?
Trying. Not, okay. I forgot what it was again.
Nature?
Yeah, I got it. 13.
Okay. Yeah, that's sufficient. This is a pretty well-known bird. This is a phoenix. These things are not seen, like, they're legendary. Because the problem is that, like, you can't catch them. You can't, like, mm-hmm. technically kill them, because they have a tendency to just spontaneously combust. So you can't, like, you can't own a phoenix. You can't, like, cage a phoenix. They're only in the wild. And as it flies past, one of its feathers flies off and into the window, and into Nomad's hands, which you put in your cap. So give me a history check, Nomad.
Hold on. History. Oh, okay. 15.
Okay, that's fine. So you do know the legends about phoenixes, and you know that they have a similar power to that of genies, in that they are powered by a very specific kind of magic. That's why they're able to reincarnate whenever they need to, and it's because they are imbued with wish magic. And specifically, their feathers are highly, highly prized, considering you can't catch them, right? You can't kill them. Mm-hmm. You can't get their you can't harvest their feathers. Mm-hmm. The only way to find one is for it to fall off naturally in the wild and for you to happen to pick it up, basically. And that's it. Like, there's been very few instances of people actually finding phoenix feathers, but you currently have one. And you know that it is powered by wish magic. So
what this wish, what is wish magic?
So this feather has the spell called wish, which you can look up on D&D Beyond. But it basically gives you one wish for pretty much anything in the universe. It's the most powerful spell in Dungeons and Dragons, and you have a single use of it for whenever you want. Just don't lose your feather.
Huh. Okay.
Yep. There you go. You get one wish. You don't have to use it now. You probably don't want to use it now. You can hold on to it forever if you want to. Okay. You have a wish spell ready to go. In your cap.
okay.
Which I will give you now, actually. And equipment. Where is my phoenix feather? There you go. You have a phoenix feather in your inventory now.
Okay, thank you.
So, did we get charges for the armor?
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out if they're actually, like, you don't have a body. I'll give you two charges. Go ahead and mark it off, two charges. I don't want to get too technical with this, right? Otherwise, mm-hmm. it's going to be too, you know, I don't want to screw you guys over on by that. It was a clever play. Even if they weren't enemies, technically.
Well, you don't have to give it to us if I did, but...
I don't want to nickel and dime you guys. If you defeat an enemy, I will give you a charge. I think it's only fair.
Okay.
Finnegan.
Yeah.
Harry was just watching puppies nap.
Right.
Right now it's like three kittens, a raccoon, and a deer.
Have the gloves of Zoltur. and I will need to modify them because I was only going to give you one glove, but now you have two. And they give you the ability to hold literally anything in your hands. Anything. Oh. They can hold, I mean, they were able to hold a...
Come here, Marcus, I'm going to hold your bones apart.
They were able to hold a sphere of annihilation. So you can touch anything you want. You can touch lava, you can hold, you know, whatever. You have the ability to physically hold any object or energy between your hands. So
the only way to move the sphere is with those gloves, right?
No, yeah. You move the spheres with magic. You can catch the spheres with the glove. It's the only thing that can touch the sphere and survive.
Yeah, I think we better not touch. I think we should leave it behind. It's a little too dangerous.
The sphere? I mean, yeah. You could. Yeah, I mean, you could.
I mean,
also,
if you drop the sphere in the ocean, it's going to drain.
If you put the sphere in your bag, horrible things will probably happen.
Yeah.
I mean, you're putting a dimensional rift inside of a dimensional portal. So don't do that.
The creators of Dungeons and Dragons might get mad at you.
Yes.
It'd be that bad.
Yes. You might kill one by accident with a heart attack. I mean, you guys can decide next time if you want to go get that sphere or not, or what you're going to do with that thing. It's mm-hmm. just, I mean, it'll just stay there otherwise, right? You know,
yeah.
And you also have George that's in the pit. So
just throw the sphere at him.
Just, oh gosh, poor George.
I know.
Don't trust him.
Jeez Louise.
Be out of his misery.
He was so trustworthy, though. What are you talking about?
I'm sure he's a monster.
I'm sure he's evil. You never know. Okay. And that's,
look, we got to the next room without needing to fight him. That means that he wasn't a part of a puzzle, which means he's evil. And the puzzle was if we pulled him up, he would kill us.
Yeah, probably. Okay, I gotta go, guys.
All right, yep.
All right, we're calling it a night.
Thanks, everybody.
Yep. All right.